Who is to me one of the finest naturalists we have around right now?
Arjunda, I can't hear you too well. I don't know about
Yeah,
the others.
we can't either.
Hello.
We can't hear you too well.
Okay.
Hello, am I audible now?
And now we can hear you.
Okay. So,
We can hear you.
good evening, everybody. It's an honor for me to introduce Sanjay Sondhi, one of my very good friend and one of the finest naturalists we have around, who is interested in any and every life form, roaming around places in northeast and western part of Himalayas all through the year. And looking for birds, butterflies, moths, and many other things, working with the communities, which is very important because Sanjay has a very good footprint among the western side of India. He works for them and with them since long, and he has a passion for butterfly and moth especially, but he has a keen interest in, I believe, in every animal life, even plant life, what
Your voice
he came
is little
across.
low.
Your voice has again
So
become low, Arjun.
I don't know, maybe some network issue. So that's it. So I will ask Sanjay to take it from now, and it will be a 1 hour long program including interactive session. So let's enjoy Sanjay's presentation. Thank you.
Thanks for the introduction, Arjun. Is my voice clear enough to everybody?
At least to me,
Yes.
yes.
Clear. Okay. So
Yes.
Arjunda is right. I enjoy watching, looking at all life forms other than Homo sapiens. But I suppose that's probably true for a lot of us nature lovers. Anyway, thanks to the Nature Meets team. I haven't really participated much in this in the big butterfly month this year because I've been in the field. But I'm going to basically talk about my experiences of butterflying in the high altitude areas of the Western Himalayas. In fact, I just came back a few days ago from Gangotri National Gang the Gangotri Na landscape. So a lot of what I'm going to say is pretty fresh for me. I'm also going to put a rider on this, which is I had given a presentation of a similar kind about a year ago, but about 50% of what I'm going to talk is new and was not covered during the last time. So I hope you all enjoy it, and please feel free to ask me any questions that you like at the end of my presentation. And if during the presentation somebody has a question, I think you can put it on the chat box, and if one of the Nature Mates people can. You feel free to interrupt me and ask me something if it is relevant to the slide that I'm presenting. So basically, okay, let me just organize myself. In terms of high altitude butterfly watching, I like to begin by saying that what's different about this area, and what is the area itself? So the way I look at the high altitude areas is basically the subalpine, alpine, and the Trans-Himalayan region, or the cold desert habitat, is the areas I'm largely going to focus on, which typically is an altitudinal belt, which is above 2,500 meters, going all the way to 5,000. But I've sort of said 4,000 because at 5,000 meters or so, there's very little insect activity. I mean, there are some butterflies that do fly. But for the better part, this is the range in which you get to see a lot of, well, not a lot of, but some butterflies. But very clearly, what's different in this area is that the insect population is quite low, including butterflies and moths. And many of the species are basically not of the oriental, not oriental species, but mainly the Palearctic species. And which is great because you won't see Palearctic species in Dehradun or in other parts of the lower parts of the Himalayas. And butterfly sightings are sometimes very, very few. There are days that I have just seen two or three individuals in a day. sometimes many more. And on many occasions, you end up doing very, very long walks in lovely landscape, but seeing very little. But whatever you see is freaked out. I mean, a lot of the things that you see in these, in this belt is stuff that is probably going to be new for you. Interestingly, you know, everyone who gets interested in butterflies heads to the Northeast. And on one occasion, I remember asking one of my friends, yeah, sab Northeast kyun jaate hain? Why aren't they coming to Western Himalayas? Because in Northwest Himalayas, there are at least 100 species that are not found anywhere else in India. I mean, and that's, I would say, given the fact that we have what, between maybe, you know, 1350 or 1400 species in India, this is a big number, right? So I think it's well worthwhile for butterfly lovers to actually visit this part of the country. And what are the things that you see? You see, you know, in the blues family or the Lycaenids, things like meadow blues, mountain blues, underwings, coppers, hair streaks. And in the nymphalids, the saturnines or the browns are in large numbers. And hence rock browns, meadow browns, walls, satyrs, arguses, lots of those. Some very, very funky pierids as well, which are basically high altitude species. I think the most prominent of these is the clouded yellows, of which there's a whole bunch of species in the Himalayan region. And then, of course, the highlight, the Apollos. I remember doing a trip with Balakrishnan Valapil to Ladakh. And he told me, Sanjay, don't show me anything else. I don't care. But if I don't see an Apollo, I mean, like my whole trip is wasted. So there are many people who like to visit basically to see Apollos. When should you visit? It's actually entirely linked to road access. I mean, you know, if you are visiting a place like Ladakh, till possibly May, the roads are closed. And hence, maybe June to September is a really good time. So the Trans-Himalayas, I think June to September is the best time. If you look at Uttarakhand, where you can access both the, you know, all the three areas, subalpine, alpine, as well as Trans-Himalayas, then probably May, June is the best period. I mean, the time you'll get maximum sightings. And obviously these, the what you see is linked to, you know, flowering season, host plants. And then you have many, many species that are only single brooded, you know, especially at the very, very high altitudes, because the season is really small. The flowering season is short compared to the rest of the country. So many species have only a single brood. And hence, don't fly for very long. So typically the three, as I said, three zones, the Trans-Himalayas, I mean, this is a typical view of the Trans-Himalayan region. This is a view of basically Khardungla, which is 5,600 meters. And, you know, I've said this to many people. I still remember I made my first visit to Ladakh, I think, in 2016. And I asked many people saying...
Himalayas are same, right?
Hello?
Ladakh and Himalayas are same, right?
Yeah, the Himalayan region includes the trans... Ladakh is basically the Trans-Himalayan region of the Himalayas. That's right. Yes. So Ladakh is part of the Himalayan region. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So I remember asking many, many people that, you know, I wanted to go and see butterflies in Ladakh. Can you help me? Can you guide me? Where can I see butterflies? And everyone told me, you're crazy. There are no butterflies in Ladakh. So all the people that I know who've been frequenting Ladakh for a long time said that you're wasting your time here. What are you going to see? And, you know, in a landscape as desolate as this, finding butterflies is not easy. So basically, when I visited, I basically said, okay, I'll just plan my own visit and I'll figure things out myself. So I've made two visits to Ladakh. On each visit, I've seen about between 40 to 45 species. And many of them have been really, really funky sightings. Then there is the alpine area, you know, the what's called the bugyas or the meadows. A very nice example of this is the Valley of Flowers, which is at about 3,600 meters in Uttarakhand. So this is the area where seasonally you will get lots and lots and lots of flowers. Unfortunately, lots of flowers does not necessarily mean lots of butterflies. So I remember that I visited the Valley of Flowers in Uttarakhand in August, I think 3 or 4 years ago. And I got to see 3 species. Okay. So maybe the season was wrong. I don't know what. There were hardly any insect activity in that month. But of course, it was great for flowers. So which was the primary reason I was visiting. I think there's a glitch. I'm just going to share my screen again. Can you all see this now? And can you hear me?
Yeah, we can see and hear.
Perfect. Okay, great. So then the third area that I'm going to talk about is the subalpine area. And this is a shot from, Gangotri. This is the Sattal trek, something that I did just last week. And in the subalpine area, you know, you've got these you've got conifers, you've got a little bit of grassland, you've got a lot of these thals, or which is these alpine lakes, and this is a very, very nice area to see butterflies as well. So what are the things that you can see? I think the one family that is poorly represented in altitudes above 2500 meters are the skippers. You don't see too many species. Probably the one species that you see reasonably often is what is called the checkered darter. This has a distribution which is basically from Kashmir to Kumaon. And it's reasonably common. I mean, if you go in the right months, you will see this. Typically, in a 5-day visit, you'll probably have between 5 to 10 sightings of this species in most parts that you'll visit. More in the Ladakh and JNK region, less in Uttarakhand. It's not so common in Uttarakhand, but you'll see it. Amongst the represented families is the Lycaenids. For me, one of my favorites is what is called the underwings. So they are basically 4 species of underwings in the Western Himalayas. And all of these have got this green colored, underside of the hindwing, which is why they are called underwings. But they are actually best separated by the upper side. So if you only get an underside shot, there's no guarantees that you'll actually be able to identify it. So this is one species, the bright green underwing. This is the next, which is the dusky green underwing. And as you can see, the upper side is changing. And then you get the large green underwing. And in fact, this is the only underwing species you get in Uttarakhand. Whereas the others are basically Kashmir and Himachal Pradesh as well. And these are very pretty butterflies. They're easy to photograph because they mud puddle a lot. If you get bright and sunny day, but very pretty to look at. If you do see them, make it a point to get the upper side. Otherwise, you may not be able to identify it with certainty. Then you have a few other butterflies such as which are easy to identify. This is the dusky meadow blue, Devanika. Not very common. It's basically Kashmir and Ladakh. Doesn't come into even Himachal or Uttarakhand. I have seen it, I think, just 2 or 3 times in my 30 days of travel in the Ladakh area. So it's not very common, but it's one of the meadow blues that is easy to identify. Then you have what's called the Eastern Baton Blue. This is quite common in the Ladakh area. If you go, the best place to see this actually is in agricultural fields. So if you go to agricultural fields which are bordered by, you know, bushes and shrubs, there's a fairly high likelihood that you'll be able to see it. This is also one of the easier butterflies to identify. You can't really confuse it for anything else. And it's quite common. But this butterfly is something that I like this. It's called the Indian white line hair streak. It's a large Lycaenid, larger than the meadow blues. And I remember when I first saw this in Ladakh, I've also seen it in Uttarakhand. I actually thought it is one of the saturnines because its flight is quite different from a Lycaenid. It actually flies very, very similar to the browns or the saturnines, which is a nymphalid. And it didn't settle down for a while the first time I saw it. So I was actually left wondering, see, kya dekh raha hu main? And then, of course, finally it sat down and it's fairly easy to photograph. And interestingly, on the second visit I made to Ladakh, we found a hill slope where we actually counted between 20 to 25 of this hair streak species in a very small patch, maybe something like 20 square meters. They were all feeding on flowering shrubs over there. I also spotted it in Uttarakhand a few years ago in Gangotri. And that was actually the first record, first published record from Uttarakhand in many, many years. I don't think there have been any recent sightings of the species from Uttarakhand. Then there is this other group, the meadow blues or the polyomatis. I get a lot of people sending me images saying, can you help identify? And in most cases, I say, not certain. I mean, there are possibly 9 species known from India. When I say possibly, because this group is a taxonomic mess, okay? It is almost impossible to identify these species using photographs. And if at all you want to identify from a photograph, you need the upper sight for sure. And the fact remains that I think a lot of work needs to go into resolving this group of species, especially for India. I mean, there is just no way that we can be certain of what we are seeing until we have specimens and we have examined probably genitalia and also done molecular work. But this species is probably the most widespread, Polyomatis ariana, and it goes all the way to Nepal. So it's also seen in Uttarakhand. And the other one that is reasonably common in the Ladakh area is the what's called the Ladakh meadow blue. As you can see, the upper sides are quite different, and hence you can separate these. But there's so much variation that, you know, trying to identify these species from just images is I think there's a great deal of uncertainty in any of the IDs of the meadow blues, or what I call the polyomatis group. This is probably the easiest one to identify. I haven't seen this. This is not my photograph. This is called the Kumau meadow blue. It is known only from northern Kumau, and it's probably one of the two endemic Uttarakhand endemics. This is a photograph taken in the alpine meadows above Munsiyari in the Pithoragarh district. And this was described actually only in 1929 by Riley from specimens in North Kumau. And it was rediscovered. I think both ZSI guys spotted it, and these guys, this local community group called Himal Prakriti in Munsiyari also spotted this butterfly. So I think this is probably one polyomatis that is very easy to identify because of its markings and the kind of sheen that it has, the coloration that it has. Then there's the mountain blues, the Albolinas, very peculiar butterflies. These are actually seen again in alpine meadows in the Trans-Himalayan landscape. And they have this tendency to crawl in under the grass blades and, you know, trying to get a photograph of the butterfly is often difficult because you see it and what it will do is it will actually crawl under a leaf blade or under a flower, so you won't be able to get the entire butterfly. Of course, when they are feeding on nectar, then it's the best time to photograph them. But this also shows a great deal of variability. And if you actually look at the images that are on IFB, I think you'll see that all of these are marked as CF because there is uncertainty in terms of their IDs just from images. Another very, very nice group, the coppers. This beautiful guy is the Ladakh copper. I think there are only a handful of photographs of this butterfly from India. It's endemic to, it's basically Kashmir and Ladakh is where it is found. It's a really, really pretty one. I would say one of the prettiest coppers that we have in India. Then there is the white-bordered copper. Actually, this is a species that you will actually see even at lower altitudes. Basically from 1500 meters upwards all the way to 3000 meters. And it's linked to its larval host plant is basically dock or sorrel, rumex, various rumex species. And wherever you get rumex, you're likely to see this butterfly. And its cousin is the common copper, which is also seen all the way up to possibly, I think I've seen it at 3,500 or 4,000 meters, if I recall. Interestingly, there are numerous subspecies. So the Ladakh, the common copper seen in Ladakh, I've got an image here, is markedly different from the one that you see in the inner Himalayas. The outer Himalayas, that is the, you know, places like Uttarakhand and Himachal. And I have a feeling that this is another thing that needs to be sorted out. It's more than, there are numerous subspecies listed for this, for the common copper in India. My own feeling is that they're probably all going to be different species. If somebody actually collects specimens and does appropriate, genitalia comparisons and phylogeny comparison, you probably find that this is a different species. That's the high altitude one is different and the one that you get in the rest of the Himalayan region is different. And then there is this very poor photograph that I have of what's called the green copper. I've seen it just once. I saw it in Great Himalayan National Park in 1990 when I was using slide films. So I have to apologize for the quality of the shot. I didn't even have a macro lens in those days. But I think it's one of the rarer coppers, more common in Kashmir and Himachal. There's just, I think, one sighting from Uttarakhand, but it isn't a common species and it's quite beautiful. And you can see, easy to identify from the upper and underside. It's green, entirely green on the underside. And typically you'll see this above 2,500 meters in the subalpine zone. Then there is, coming to the nymphalids, the meadow browns, 8 species in India. I mean, I've photographed a whole bunch of them. Many of them are cryptic and you need the upper sides to be certain. So if you are ever seeing these dusky meadow browns, please do try and get the upper side. Even if you're getting the upper side in flight, it's fine. It doesn't matter. But with a high shutter speed, you can get the upper side images and that helps in identifying them. These are respectively the one on the top left is the short-branded meadow brown. Then there's the dusky meadow brown and the tawny meadow brown. Very similar species. But I still remember the first time I saw a meadow brown in the Trans-Himalayan region. We were driving on the road and there was basically, it was a rocky hill slope, hardly any vegetation. And I saw something flying and I told the guys with me saying, stop the car, stop the car. They said, yahan kyun ruk raha hai, kuch nahi hai. can't you see? There are no plants, there's nothing. I said, just stop the car. And this was like maybe just 30 minutes outside of Leh. And I stopped the car and I got down and I chased this butterfly. And sure enough, it was the dusky meadow ground. And there were quite a few of them, at least four or five butterflies flying there. And, you know, they feed on these, the flowers of these small shrubs that are there in the Trans-Himalayan region. So anyone who's going butterflying in that, in the Trans-Himalayan region, don't get fooled by the habitat. You know, even if there's a small amount of greenery, there could be things that you could see there. This is tawny rock brown, two species. Again, here you need the upper side. So do make sure that you are photographing both upper and under of the species to separate it. And then this butterfly is something that I got on my last visit to Ladakh. It's Paroensis pumilis, the Ladakh mountain satyr. And I'd been looking for this. I mean, in my first visit to Ladakh, I was looking for this butterfly. We didn't see it. The second visit at a different spot, I saw this in a meadow. And if I recall correctly, there were about 50 individuals flying in that meadow. And so they were locally very, very common. But we saw them in maybe three or four locations overall. And it's a beautiful butterfly, but it's got this really weird behavior where you can see here that you know, it basically crawls through the grass. You can actually see these two butterflies. They may be a male and female. Maybe it's a courtship of some kind. But the butterfly has a tendency to drop down into the meadow and then virtually crawl under the grass so that it's camouflaged. And you're trying to get images of it where, you know, only when it's nectaring do you actually get a clear shot. If it is sitting in the meadow, it's probably going to be, you know, trying to crawl its way and hide amidst the grass blades. And I saw them do this repeatedly. I mean, they would fly, settle, and they would actually crawl, virtually crawl on the ground, trying to get under grass blades in the alpine meadow. If there are any scientists and serious researchers on this call, you know, Karanasa species, I've labeled this as CF hubneri, but I really don't know, okay? I mean, there are something like 4 to 6 species known from the Indian Himalayas, this Karanasa group. Highly complex. These were all described based on species and subspecies that Evans had laid out more than 100 years ago. And I think we just don't know anything about this group. This genus, we need to sort it out. The differences that Evans mentions in his book to separate these are so insignificant that it's impossible to be certain. And the thing is, you can make out it's a Karanasa, but you just cannot be certain what species it is. And the problem in the high altitude Himalayas is that, especially in the outer Himalayas, that you may actually be getting different species from valley to valley. And actually, that's what Evans did. He described a number of different subspecies based on regions of Ladakh, saying, you know, northern region, one species, southern region, another species, and so on and so forth. But nobody really knows as to whether these are species, subspecies, forms, basically taxonomic resolution needed for this genus for certain. Another nice group is the satyrs. Again, basically montane species, 5 species of Olocera in the Western Himalayas. This is the one that you normally see in the higher altitudes. These photographs, I think, are either from Ladakh or from the Valley of Flowers. And easy to identify this one. Then you have the common satyr. Again, in the inner Himalayas, you have, you know, like, if you look at literature, these two species are considered Olocera swaha, common satyr. But the one that you see at high altitudes, which is Garuna, is completely yellow, both underside and when it on the upper side also, it's a bright yellow. And the one you see in the outer Himalayas, the lower altitudes, is the other one, the one on the bottom right. My view is these are two different species. I have seen both of them fly. I've seen their habits. I've seen their habitats. I don't know why they've been defined as a subspecies. I mean, with much lesser differences, we, you know, declare taxon as different species. I think once somebody gets into looking at genitalia and molecular phenology, these are going to be two different species. I'm very, very confident of that. Because they are so, so different, even from external morphology standpoint. So this, the Garuna, you will actually see above 3,000 meter in the inner Himalayas all the way to Uttarakhand. And then when you, if you come to areas like Mussoorie and stuff like that, you'll see this, the other one. Two other species, the striated satyr and the great satyr. The striated is basically a single brooded species that flies basically primarily in August and September. All the other satyrs are basically double brooded. But if you want to see this one, you basically need to be in the subalpine zone in August and September. Coming to the tortoise shells, the mountain tortoise shell, recorded in Uttarakhand after many years. I think there are just a few records. This is a photograph taken by Trilok Rana. He's from the Munsiari group that does ecotourism. And I think last year, if I'm not mistaken, Arun Pratap Singh also published a paper saying mountain tortoiseshell sighted in Uttarakhand after more than 100 years. But it is seen in from Kashmir east to Sikkim. So there may be other sightings in rest of the country, but not many, not very many sightings of this species. This one is more common, the Ladakh tortoise shell. So we had a, you know, this was one of the species that was on my list to see. And my first visit to Ladakh was in the month of June and July. And we didn't see a single one. And I was so disappointed. And then my next visit was in the month of August. And we saw two of these, but we saw hundreds of caterpillars. Hundreds and hundreds of caterpillars. It's larval host plant, basically a different species of stinging nettle, Urtica hyperborea. And we saw dozens and dozens of caterpillars. I'm fairly certain that if somebody had visited a few weeks after us, this species would have been seen almost everywhere. And you can see the caterpillar also in the image above. Then there's the mountain tortoiseshell, the large tortoiseshell. It's not really an aglais, it's a different genus. But I have seen this in Uttarakhand on a number of occasions, but always in the month of March. And always, if you can see this individual also, it's very worn. And it's my belief that this species for certain overwinters. Because if they are emerging around the 15th of March, and they are as battered as they are, it's probably an indication that the adult of this species overwinters, and they emerge as soon as it starts getting a little bit warm. But they're all worn specimens, all worn individuals. But this is just a hypothesis. I don't know whether this is true, but I do believe that this species overwinters because I've seen more than one individual which is worn in this kind. Then the other very, very pretty, beautiful butterflies are the fritillaries. You know, the most common fritillary is what we call the Himalayan queen fritillary. So I'm not going to talk about that. This one is the high brown fritillary, Jainadeva. So there are two subspecies. The Ladakh one is called Topsiphon, whereas the one in Himachal and Uttarakhand is Jainadeva. So they are slightly different. I think they may be different species as well, but remains to be seen. This is the one that is found in Ladakh, which is Topsiphon. And last week, I photographed some of these in Uttarakhand as well. And then this is the common silver stripe. looks very much like the large silver stripe, which is very common across the Himalayas, including Northeast India. But the upper side is quite different. It doesn't have the blue on the upper hind that the large silver stripe has. And where you do see these butterflies, this basically is seen in the subalpine zone. So in the areas between 2,500 meters to 3,000 meters, these would be fairly common. And there's normally fairly large numbers of them. If you do see one, you'll see a dozen or two. Then this butterfly is another really, really cute one. Black vein fritillary. When I first saw this butterfly, I actually thought it's a moth. Okay, this butterfly was sitting as though it was dead at about 9 a.m. in Ladakh in swampy land. They basically, I've always seen them in very, very swampy meadows where there's a lot of slush and a lot of flowers. And when I saw it, I said, ye kya hai? Ye toh mujhe moth lag raha hai. But when I went close and I saw it, I said, no man, it's a butterfly. And to show you how tiny it is, this gives you a sense of, I think it's one of the tiniest brush-footed butterflies we have. It's really small and it sits in this weird fashion, with wings closed amongst the blades of grass. And it's difficult to spot also because it's so small. But on our second visit, we saw lots of them. I mean, they are basically a swampy land with flowers, and you're fairly certain to see this species, especially in Ladakh. Coming to the pierids, fairy clouded yellow. Lots of clouded yellows, more than a dozen species. But these are very irritating butterflies. Okay. The reason I say they are very irritating butterflies is that typically you will see a clouded yellow in an alpine meadow and it will not be sitting, it will be flying. So you see it and what you need to do is you need to chase it. And when you chase it at 3,500 or 4,000 meters, a guy like me who's not very fit, I'm huffing and panting because there's anyway oxygen is low there. And these guys don't sit. They'll keep flying and you'll keep chasing them and you just hope for the fact that one of them will settle down and you'll be able to photograph it. So there's lots of these clouded yellows flying typically in the distance. And this one was relatively easier because they were nectaring and we could photograph them. This one, orange clouded yellow, I remember I was in an alpine meadow in Ladakh. I spent an hour and a half trying to photograph, just get a single photograph of this species. They just kept flying. They wouldn't settle down. And there were more than a dozen of them in that meadow. And I just kept chasing after one, then another, then another. And finally got a few pictures. But very irritating butterflies to photograph because they don't sit down much. Then, you see this, there is this cabbage white. I was very, very surprised. This was on my list when I went to Ladakh. Didn't see it on my first visit, but on my second visit in August, there were dozens of them. It's known basically only from Kashmir in India. There are records from Uttarakhand and there are records from Himachal. But I think these records are suspect because there was no evidence that was posted along with. There was no images, and I think just people just mistook them for mistook the Indian cabbage white for this species. You see them in agricultural fields around Leh in the right season. If you go, they're fairly common, and they're easy to identify if you get the upper side. No difficulty in identification. Then another butterfly that's only restricted to Kashmir is the Pieris Deota. It's called the Kashmir White. And we basically saw it quite commonly, easy to identify. We reared them as well. We've got the eggs. We've got the entire life cycle recorded in the paper that we published. So it's easy to see easy to photograph as well. And basically, Ladakh is the place to go if you want to see this. And then you have the bath whites, two species. You know, the common bath white is, of course, seen throughout the Himalayas, all the way to eastern Himalayas and even northeast India. But these are the West Himalayan species. There's, I think, three species of Pontia. And these two are reasonably common, Calidice and the lesser bath white and the lofty bath white. In Ladakh and even in Himachal, I think you'll see them. They're less common in Uttarakhand, but they're reasonably easy to see and fairly easy to identify as well. This is another one of the chasers. I mean, I saw this just once, the Butler's dwarf. If I'm not mistaken, I chased it for about 20 minutes before it sat down. And I was huffing and puffing, out of breath, could hardly hold my camera. I think at about 4,000 meters. Very few sightings from Uttarakhand, but Kumaon and I think Himachal Pradesh, there have been records of this species over the years. This is again a very peculiar species, the lesser brimstone. You know, when I read up old literature, I read Winter Blythe and stuff like that, they say it's fairly common. But I have just seen it once. And as you can see, this species, just like the tortoiseshell I showed you, is very worn. And the brimstones are known to overwinter. I mean, the reason why the brimstone gets, the people say that the name butterfly comes from the origin of the, I mean, it's anecdotal. The origin of the name of the butterfly is from the brimstone butterfly, because it seems like butterflying. And this group, all the brimstones are known to overwinter. And the lesser brimstone actually is fairly easy to identify, because the forewing and the hindwing are differently colored. So even if you see it flying, you can actually make out that it has a dual tone. The forewing is differently colored and the hindwing is differently colored. But I have just seen this once, and I haven't seen many other records of people of this species. So I don't know whether there's a reduction in population, or it's just that we're not going to the right places to find this. So it's another uncommon species that was common in the past, but is not being seen too often today. Coming to the... Yes.
So the session after this session, will this session be there every Monday?
I think the Nature Mates folks...
Actually, this is for Big Butterfly Month. So we are doing this to raise awareness on butterflies. So we had a lot of sessions throughout the month, and Sanjay is doing this session to tell us about the butterflies of high altitude. We have had a lot of it, and you can go to our YouTube page or our Facebook page, and a lot of other interesting talks are there. If you want to see, you can check them out.
Okay. Thank you.
So coming to the papilios, basically, this is the common yellow swallowtail, fairly common butterfly that you see both in Himachal and Uttarakhand. And this is basically called Papilio Bachao Asiaticus. The reason I give the scientific name here is that this one is the one you see in Ladakh. And this is called Ladakhensis. Now, for the life of me, I can't figure out why these are subspecies. I think they should just be two different species. I mean, you can just see the shape and the markings of the two are fairly different. So this is another group that needs taxonomic resolution. And there are, I think, three or four subspecies from the India, one in eastern Himalayas, one in the outer Himalayas of western Himalayas, and one in the inner Himalayas. They're probably all going to be different species if somebody spends time and looks into it. We've reared this species as well, and that's the caterpillar that we found. And then the final highlight that, why a lot of people visit, basically the Apollos. So I remember when I made my visit, I had seen Apollos before, but when I was going to Ladakh, there's something like, I think 12 or 13 species across the Himalayan Himalayan region, Western Himalayas. And I was quite keen. We saw a few Apollos on our first visit. And I had read about the fact that many of the Apollos are not really uncommon. And in fact, Winterblythe and some of the other older authors talk of swarms of Apollos of every species. They say every single species of Apollo has swarms. And I was saying, I hope I can witness one of these. And sure enough, we were very, very fortunate that on our second visit, we witnessed swarms of Apollos. That means they were basically what we observed was that on the south-facing hill slopes of virtually below every pass, maybe a few hundred meters below every pass we crossed, we would have swarms of these butterflies. In one location, I think, if I remember correctly, we actually counted something like 200 of these individuals. There were so many of them that they were getting killed by the cars and they were lying dead on the road. And I mean, they were like, we counted 200, they may have been three or four times that number. If they were all common red Apollos. And it is mentioned in literature that they swarm, but I don't think there are very, very few published, very, very little published information in recent times of these swarms. So it's a very hardy butterfly. And it actually is, we actually saw, you know, I read about the fact that they're very hardy butterflies, but I actually saw butterflies that were getting hit by cars and within a few minutes recovering and flying off again. So they are tough little insects. And very interestingly, they also display this crawling behavior. So you can actually see that, you know, what the butterfly does is it lands in a patch and it, to get to safety, it crawls under rocks. And you can see this is a butterfly that is actually trying to crawl under a rock and hide itself. I'm not certain whether they were doing this primarily from the point of view of camouflage or whether it was the female that was actually looking for a larval host plant to lay its eggs. I'm still not certain as to why they were doing this, but we observed this many times that they would land on a hill slope and they would crawl under a rock either to hide themselves or perhaps looking for a place to lay their eggs. This is another Apollo that we spotted, the keeled Apollo. Again, the Apollo is another group which needs a lot of taxonomic resolution, and I think somebody needs to work on it. And this one is the blue Apollo. So the blue and the red Apollos are the most common, and you can probably see them down to, I think, probably even 2,000 meters. Almost any hill station, if you go in the right season, you'll see the red Apollo and the blue Apollo. So this really is a summary of my talk. What are the best places to visit? I think Ladakh is great because of access. GHNP is great, but you need to trek and you need to be prepared to walk to the higher altitudes of most of the Himachal areas other than Lahol Spiti where you can drive. And then in Uttarakhand, you have Gangotri, Govind Pashu Vihar, you know, a whole bunch of, I've listed the protected areas. And these are good places to visit. Again, the road network in Uttarakhand is quite good. So it's easy to get to the subalpine, alpine, and the trans-Himalayan region. And right now, I'm in the process of doing a two-year biodiversity assessment for a forest department in the Gangotri landscape. And I will be doing something like maybe 8 to 10 visits over the next 2 years. I made my first visit last week. We are looking at birds, butterflies, moths, wildflowers, and anything else we can see. And we will be launching a Volunteers for Conservation program where people who would like to visit can volunteer and join us. We'll probably announce it sometime early next year. So I think that covers my presentation.
Hello.
Sorry, my cat wanted to be let in, so I had to step out. Please, you know, Big Butterfly Month is here for everybody. Please do post your images on Butterflies of India. It's the best known resource for, you know, butterflies from an Indian context.
Yes, sir.
Everyone should do that. And now if you have any questions, please feel free to ask. I hope everybody heard that and I hope it was enjoyable.
Yeah, we have a few questions in the chat box.
Please, can you, okay, do you want me to get to the chat box?
I can say it out loud.
Yeah, if you can, that'll be nice.
Yeah, so Aparna is asking that, is saying, good evening, Sanjay sir. Thank you for speaking on this very interesting topic. A couple of questions, wait. Hello? When you say Northwest Himalaya, which areas or states in India and in other countries does it cover? Also, would you... One sec, I am continuously using my space. Also, could you please explain what are Palearctic and Oriental species?
So when I say Northwest Himalayas, I'm basically referring to Kashmir, Ladakh, Himachal and Uttarakhand. Nepal very clearly is the central Himalayas, and then Arunachal eastwards is the eastern Himalayas. Yeah, and if you want to know what is Palearctic and Oriental region,
species, yeah.
Yeah, so basically the Oriental the Palearctic region is basically the high altitude colder areas. A large part of Europe and the northern Himalayan region are the Palearctic zones. You know, they are geographic zones in the world linked to habitat, climate, and stuff like that. So the high altitude areas of the Himalayan region are Palearctic, and the warmer climes or the tropical regions are basically the Oriental regions. So the species that you have can be either Oriental or Palearctic, or depending on which geographic zone you're talking about. I hope that helps.
Yeah, Monica has a question. It's amazing to know that you have seen 50 plus Ladakh mountain satyr. Any interesting reason behind their migration or puddling?
Well, they were not migrating. They were all just in one meadow. I mean, most of them were either mating or feeding, nectaring. And I think the thing very simply is that in areas like Ladakh or the Palearctic region, the larval host plants of these species are probably quote-unquote restricted to some very small niches. And hence that these species would tend to occupy alpine meadows where their larval host plant is present. Of course, a lot of the satyrines basically lay their eggs on various species of grasses, but I don't think anyone has ever documented the life cycle of the Ladakh mountain satyr. So I'm not sure anyone really knows what its host plant is. It's very clearly linked to its host plant. I mean, I don't think it could be anything else.
So Prakriti has a question like, sir, can you please differentiate Indian and Nepalese cabbage white?
The Nepal cabbage white. I'm not familiar with the Nepal species. Yeah, I don't. I haven't seen it, and I don't know. Is it a different species? Do you know the scientific name?
Whoever asked that question. Yeah, here you can unmute and answer.
Nepal cabbage white. Is it a different species? I don't know. I haven't seen this. So Nepal cabbage white. So I don't see anything coming up for Nepal cabbage white being a separate species though.
I think it would be the same one that we have.
Yeah, yeah. So I think what I can see online is that basically there is Pieris brassica, which is a different subspecies. So it's a different subspecies of the large cabbage white from what I can see online. Unless there's a different Pieris, which is called the Nepal white, I'm not familiar with it.
So there's Kismat who wants your Facebook account details. So if you could provide it in the chat or your email or something.
I look at my Facebook account once in a month. I'm not active on Facebook. Yeah. If you want, you can, I'll write my email and... my phone number. You can contact me on WhatsApp, but don't bother to contact me on Facebook because I'm not active here. There you go. Okay. So even if you send me a friend request, I may not answer. I go to my Facebook page once a month there, basically.
So Surabhi wants to say hi to your cat.
Yeah, she was not happy with the fact I'm ignoring her. So.
So we have a question from Monica. Like, is Ladakh nettle the same as bichu ghas, what's called locally?
Yeah, so basically there are various species of nettle, right? So what is called as bichu ghas, say in Uttarakhand or in Himachal, there are different species. There's lots of species that are called nettle. What is known as bichu ghas in Uttarakhand is the same genus Urtica, but it's a different species from the one that I showed, which was in Ladakh. But yes, it's stinging nettle at the end of the day.
And Sanej wants to ask whether there's any genetic study like barcoding going on. I assume he wants to know about India, probably.
There are people like ZSI who are doing barcoding to some extent, but I think it's fairly new, and I don't think there is, for example, the high altitude species in Himalayas. I don't think there's any focused study where people are trying to resolve the taxonomic issues that I raised in my presentation. I mean, there's lots of species, the Polyomatis, the Apollos, the Karanasa, the yellow swallowtail, the Olocera, the common satyr, all of these need taxonomic resolution. I don't think anyone is really specifically working on it yet. If there are some students on this group, please do take it up. Yeah.
So if nobody has any other question, I would like to really thank Sanjay for taking time out today. And your images were beautiful, and that Gangotri volunteer, I don't know, if I have some spare time, I'll definitely ask Arjuna to give me some time so that I can go and volunteer with you guys. Like, it looks like a really interesting opportunity. I've never been there. So, yeah. And thank you so much for your presentation today. And looking forward to, do some collaborative work in the future. Yeah. Does anybody want to ask Sanjay anything else? Okay. So, Ashish is saying thank you for your session. It's very informative and interesting.
So, yeah. Okay, great. I hope people enjoyed it, and I hope it was nice.
And, thank you
feel,
so much.
Feel free to reach out if you have any specific questions. And
Sanjay has shared his email there, so note it down, guys, and you can just contact him directly. Thank you so much, Sanjay.
Okay, thanks everybody.
Bye.
Thanks. Bye.